Hello, and welcome to the R3S stage on the RC3 on day two of a great online conference, and hopefully the last one. So today we are going to speak about, we're going to hear a talk about military grade AES-1024 bit encryption from Sylvain and Boi. But before we go there, I want to share with you some information. First of all, this talk will be in English and it will be translated to German. Dieser Talk wird auf Englisch gehalten, wird allerdings auch auf Deutsch übersetzt. Die entsprechenden Konfigurationen findet ihr in eurem Webplayer oder in der Software eurer Wahl, die ihr benutzt, um euch diesen Stream anzugucken. Dann, wir haben heute Abend mal wieder eine Lightning-Runde. Tonight there will be a lightning round of talks, 5 minutes each. And we still are looking for submissions. For that, please refer to the blog post, to the relevant blog post. And if you submit, please include your event phone number so that we can reach you and we can get in contact with you. Furthermore, there is the Herald News Show, where we are looking for submissions to keep people up to date for what's happening. And for that, of course, we need to know what is happening. So if you want to share something with us, please feel free to share it at c3news.show. And of course, there will be a Q&A afterwards and you can submit questions on various platforms, either being HackInt or in the channel R3S, or on the Mastodons and Twitters of this world with the hashtag R3S or RC3R3S and so on and so forth. I'm sure you will find a way to contact us. Last but not least, I have to unlock my phone. About the speakers. Sylvain does crypto for a living. Who wouldn't like to do that? And he also likes to spend his time doing crypto, hardware attacks, and security research in general. And also somehow he likes playing CTFs. That doesn't fit the profile at all. And then there is Boi, who is also a security researcher in his own right and does this also as a job. And of course, he likes cryptography, hacking, and salsa dancing. What else? So, and with that, give it up for Sylvain and Boi.
Hello. Thank you for joining us to our presentation. So I'm Sylvain. I will present you what brings me to bruteforce AES-1024 military-grade encryption and what does it mean. And then Boi will explain how he patched some problem I discovered during my research. So this project started during a forensic project. One of my colleagues received a USB key containing a vault encrypted with SanDisk secure access software. He asked me if it's possible to brute force the password of the vault. So I started my research with that. Finally, meanwhile, he found the password elsewhere, basically written on a post-it. So it could have been end of the story. But while I was researching about this software, I discovered that it is distributed by default on any SanDisk storage product you buy as a simple binary. So you execute it once, you configure your vault, and then when you launch the vault, the software, it will ask you your password. You enter it, and if it is correct, it lets you access to your file. You can import file, export them, display them. So nothing really new as a vault solution. But I figure out that in the preferences, you can choose the encryption method. So by default, it is set to AES 128 bit. But if you buy the premium version, you can go up to AES 1024 bit. So I was a bit surprised, and it started to interest me because, as you may know, AES is not standardized for key larger than 256 bit. So I was interested to know how AES 1024 was implemented in this solution. So I dig a bit deeper, and I figure out that this solution is developed by a company called ENC Security. And on their website, they have really strong security claims. They say that they use ultimate encryption using 1024-bit AES keys, military grade. So then I was even more interested to dig deeper to see how this solution works. And especially because each time I see military grade, I always think about this tweet by Crypto Dictionary. And it always tell me, okay, now you have to look inside the solution to discover how it is implemented. Joke apart, this is an interesting software to analyze. As I said, it's developed by ENC Security, and it is a general solution. It seems it is used by Lexar, Sony, and Western Digital by default in various storage products. And even though it seems to be widely distributed, it was not yet supported by Hashcat nor John the Ripper for password brute force. So from a forensic point of view, it was interesting for us to have a solution to brute force this kind of vault if in the future we receive this vault. And also, of course, I wanted to know if I'm able to brute force AES 1024. So I started my reverse. It turns out that the solution is a P32-bit binary of about 10 megabytes. It is packed with UPX, so I was able to unpack it with PXplorer. It ran perfectly. There were no further debug protections, so I could debug it, put breakpoint, and so on. It is written in C++, compiled with Visual Studio, so it was a bit painful to reverse C++, but I use Ghidra and tools in Ghidra to have it decompiled properly. And I use as well Radar 2 for some further disassembler. And the solution use Qt for graphic user interface and OpenSSL for the cryptographic implementation. The first difficulty I got was when you execute the binary at another place than the storage, you have an error message saying that this application runs only on the storage of the brand. For example, here it is the Sony solution. So for SanDisk, it was okay. I got a USB key, but for Sony, I had no SSD. So I started searching this string in the binary. I figured out that it was just after a branch. So I blindly patched this branch, this instruction, GNE to GE, like cracking in the 90s. And then the binary executed it properly without any further check. So I was able to debug it from any place I wanted. So it was quite convenient, and it reminded me good memory about cracking. Then another feature I use massively for this project was Ghidra function ID. So since I knew that OpenSSL and Qt were used in this solution, I created signature from the compiled version of the library for the same architecture. And then it could detect the signature in my binary. So as soon as it is detected in Ghidra, it adds the comment just before the function, and it helps you a lot for reversing. I could avoid the function related to the GUI, and I could dig a bit deeper in the crypto function. So that was really convenient for, and it really helped me to be faster for the reverse. Then I started to see how the binary behave. So I run process monitor and I enter a wrong password. And I figure out that only one file in the preference folder is open during the process. It is file system.dat. And then the file is read. And if the password is wrong, it is closed, and then a sound is played. So I knew that my password the derivation of my password is compared to something in this file. If we step back a bit here and we go to the general problem, we are trying to reverse a password hashing algorithm. So basically, we want to derive a key from a user password, and then we will use this key to encrypt data. Usually, when we do that, we use a unique and random salt to avoid an attacker to do a dictionary or rainbow table attack. We have a parameter which is called the iteration number, which help us to adapt the work factor, so to slow down the brute force. And today, the recommended algorithm are PBKDF2, which stands for password-based key derivation function 2. We have balloon hashing, which is recommended by NIST password guidelines. We have Scrypt. And more recently, we got Argon2, which is the winner of the password hashing competition. So if you are interested by this topic of password hashing, I would strongly suggest you to go and check the literature about password hashing competition. It's really, really interesting. For this project, I was interested by PBKDF2. So the construction is quite simple. We input the salt concatenated with the constant 1 to a hashMAC function, and the user password is used as a key for this function. And then we iterate C times this hashMAC function. So here C is the iteration number. We XOR all the intermediate results, and at the end we obtain the key. The first problem here is that, okay, but what if we want a key larger than the hashMAC output? For example, what is it possible to have a 1024-bit key if we have only 16 bytes of output from the hashMAC? And in fact, this was the first problem of PBKDF1, the first version of this algorithm. And this was solved in PBKDF2 by just considering that the key outputted here is the first key. And then we run this algorithm a second time with the constant 2, which is concatenated with the salt, and we obtain a second key. And we can repeat this process again and again. And at the end, when we have generated enough key byte, we concatenate all of them and we obtain the final key. For example, if we want a 1024-bit key and we have only 16 bytes of output, we do 8 iterations of the process and we obtain the final key. So this is fine here, but what is inside the binary? I reversed it, and in fact, I discover that the number of iteration is hard-coded, and then we have a loop with hash function inside it. So I reverse this main loop, and I figure out that the construction for the key derivation function is really close to PBKDF2, except that the function used is not a hashMAC, but MD5, a hash function. And the password is hashed a first time and then input it to MD5 again and again, 1,000 times. And the key is outputted the same way. Another difference is that the salt and the constant are hashed a first time by MD5 and XOR to the result. So it was close to PBKDF2, but with some differences. The first thing I struggled was, okay, I could figure out the algorithm, but I couldn't find from where the salt came from. But I found a string which was hard-coded in the code, which looks random, but it is always the same because it is in the code. And it turns out that this string is a salt of my key derivation function. So it was random, but obviously it was not a unique per user. It's really not a good practice. I mean, it brings some possible attack, because you can have dictionary or rainbow table attack for a user. And in fact, I checked for other version for other vendors, and it turns out that the same value is used for all the vendors. So your dictionary attack can work for a Sony user and a Salt user exactly the same way, which was the first vulnerability I discovered here in this solution. Another less important problem is the iteration number. For it, 1,000 iteration was a recommended number of iteration when PBKDF2 was out. But now, for example, OWASP recommend 310,000 iteration or more for PBKDF2 using HMAC SHA-256. So this number of iteration should be higher or should be updatable in for this solution. But there is another bigger problem here, and it's really a construction problem. If you look in the blue part of, I put it here on this algorithm, you can see that it does not depend of the salt and the constant. So we can pre-compute this part, this 1,000 times MD5, and then we can reuse this pre-computed value to compute the second key. And the work factor really disappears because we have to compute just one time the iterations and reuse them for all the key we have generated. So it's really a design problem. So, and here we can see that between a 128-bit key compared to a 1024-bit key, it's simply a XOR operation. And in addition, we can reuse this pre-computation to have a dictionary attack, a pre-computed attack, for even if the salt is randomly generated and unique per user, because we can pre-compute our dictionary and just XOR this value to the the hash of the salt and the constant. So we can see here that even if it's close to PBKDF2, it doesn't reach the same level of security, and there is a design problem here. So that was the key derivation function. Now let's see how the key verification works. So to verify that the password of a user is correct, after we have generated keys, we will read the file system.dat, as I explained before, and we will decrypt the value store in this file. And if a word is a clear text word equals D2C3B4A1, then the software considers the password to be correct. The first thing I needed to know is, okay, but what is the encryption algorithm used to decrypt the file system.dat? And this part of the code was not identified by Gidra function ID. And it was using a lot of SSC instruction, which was really hard to reverse. And even the decompilation was not helping much, but I knew that it uses OpenSSL. So I started to read some parts, to search in the source code of OpenSSL. And I found a Perl script which generate SSE instruction to implement AES exactly in the same order as the instruction I got in my disassembly. So then I could figure out that AES was used for the decryption. And in fact, it turns out it was AES in counter mode. So for AES-128, it was AES in counter mode, which was simple. So then I thought, okay, for AES-256, it must be AES-256 block in CTR mode. But in fact, it was not. It was two iterations of AES-128, but the nonce was XOR with the second key generated by the key derivation function. And then the key stream is XOR again with the ciphertext to obtain the plain text. So then it was not difficult to figure out how AES-512 and AES-1024 worked. It was simply the same, but with four iterations for AES-512 and eight iterations for AES-1024, and always with the keys generated by the key derivation function XOR with the nonce. And we can remark here that only the first 8 bytes of the key were XOR with the nonce. The counter was left untouched before the encryption. So here's the difference between AES-128 and AES-1024 modes was only the number of AES encryption. And in addition, only half of the generated key bits were used, because even though we generated 1024 bits, only half of them were XOR with the nonce. Anyway, at the end, the level of security cannot be higher than the level of security of the user password. If it has a low entropy, then the security cannot be higher than this entropy. Nevertheless, the nonce were randomly generated with OpenSSL with run bytes function, so it was really fine with this with those nonce. So at this state of the project, I got everything I needed to implement a brute force in John the Ripper. So I created a Python script to extract the encrypted data, the nonces, and everything I needed to brute force the vault. I figured out that you can have false positives after about 2 to the 32 candidates, because you are testing your password against just a 32-bit word. However, for SanDisk and Sony, you have the version right after this magic run, so it helps you to sort the false positive. So my implementation is available on my GitHub, and it will be soon integrated in the main John the Ripper repository. So now everybody is able to brute force AES-1024, and I encourage you to test my implementation and tell me what you think. So now let's see how it works in practice. So if you execute John on the hash you obtain with my script, it will brute force the password. Here it found the password because it was in my password list. It found it after 2 seconds of execution, and John the Ripper was able to test about 7,000 passwords per second. If we compare this to PBKDF2 using 310,000 iterations, we can see that John will figure out the password used because I use exactly the same list, but it will find it after 2 minutes, which is quite longer. And John is able to test only 30 passwords per second, which is really, really slower. And it shows how the algorithm and the number of iteration influence the result here. So that was it for the key derivation function and password cracking. The only thing missing for the reverse was how the file encryption worked. And in fact, after the password is verified, there is a file containing all the file encryption key, which is decrypted with the generated keys. And then those key are used to encrypt the files individually. So this is a standard solution and quite good, because if the user changed his password, you don't have to re-encrypt all the vault, which is really slow, but just this file, and the file encryption keys will stay untouched and will stay the same. And one thing missing was, okay, but what is the file encryption algorithm? So at the beginning, I thought, well, it is the same as the one used to verify the user password. And for AES-1028 mode, it is indeed exactly the same. It is AES-1028 in CTR mode. But then when I executed my script to test for AES-256 mode, I was surprised that it was not working properly. So I reversed a bit the file encryption more. And I could find that, in fact, there were a small modification. The second key, the second file encryption key, is now fully XORed with the nonce and the counter. The 16 bytes of this key is XORed before the encryption. And then it is used to generate a second key stream and XOR with the first output to obtain the plain text. So I corrected my script. But then again, for AES-512, it was not working the same way as for the key verification. So I reversed again. And I figure out that for AES-512, only two iterations of AES-128 were used, but only with the last file encryption key. So I was a bit surprised. It was really interesting to me. And it was the same for AES-1024, except that we use the last, the eighth file encryption key. So now I got everything I needed for the file encryption. I could reverse the file format. So in the encrypted file, we have first the IV in clear, the nonce. Then we have a version number. We have a parameter telling which algorithm we are using. Here, 4 stands for AES-1024. And then we have the file name length in clear. Then encrypted with the algorithm I described before, we have the file name, we have zeros, and at offset 0x200, we have the plain text in clear. The second problem I discovered here was that it is a CTR-like design. Even if there is several iteration, it is almost the same as a CTR mode of operation. And you can have file malleability, meaning that if someone is able to modify your file, then it will be decrypted exactly with the same modification, and it won't be detected by this solution. So that was a problem. If, for example, you store your vault in the cloud, or if someone has access to your vault. Again, nonces were randomly generated with OpenSSL, so there were not the problem of nonce reuse. It was perfectly fine. But since there is only two iterations of AES, we got only a maximum of 256 bits of security level. And in fact, if we go a bit deeper, so what if we got only the encrypted file, we can, I mean, theoretically brute force 128 bits for the first file encryption key. And then we have to brute force the last file encryption key, which is XOR with the IV, because we don't know it. So we have indeed a security level up to 256 bits. But if we do a bit of cryptography here, and we assume that we have two plain text blocks equal to zero, and we have their corresponding ciphertext C1 and C2. Then we can write the equations for the encryption. And we know that C1 equals AES used with the first file encryption key of the first IV, XOR with AES of the first IV, XOR with the last file encryption key. And here the plain text is not in the equation because we have make the hypothesis it is zero. And we can write the same for the second ciphertext. Then if we rearrange the equation and we XOR them together, we obtain this last equation, which depends only on the first file encryption key and not on the last encryption key, because it cancelled out. And we, meaning that we can test this left part of the equation with the first, for all the possible file encryption key, and test if it equals to IV1 XOR with IV2, which are known because they are in clear in the file. And as soon as this equation is satisfied, we know that we have guessed the correct key. So it gives a theoretical reduction of 128 bits of security. This is theoretical. It assumes that we got a zero block in our file encrypted. But in fact, if you remember well, it turns out that we know from where the file name end encrypted, and then we know that we have zero until 0x200 offset. So we can use this information to have zero block. And in fact, we can, I mean, this reduction, this security reduction apply for this solution. So as soon as I got my result, I contacted ANC Security in May this year. So they acknowledge of the vulnerabilities, so the key derivation function problem and the file malleability problem. Then the vulnerabilities were disclosed to Sony, Western Digital, and Lexar. I got a meeting with ENC Security to agree on the deadline and also to handle the disclosure to the vendors. Then I received two CVE, one for the key derivation function and one for the file malleability. And then in September, it turned out that this key derivation function is used in other Western Digital applications. So we extended the deadline to the 22nd of December. So that was all the finding I found for this solution. And now I will let Boi present his part.
Yes, thank you, Sylvain. So I'm now going to hold this presentation from the view of ENC Security. So I'm going to tell our side of the story, the interesting events that happened, the challenges that we faced, choices that we made, and I guess for this audience, always interesting how we actually came to the designs that were that we made for fixing those issues. A slight bit of background here. So the company actually was founded in 2009, and we have millions of people using the software. And part of that is because we have OEM versions. So what happened is that we managed to sell the product on USB devices, USB storage devices. So for example, that would be SanDisk, which is still our biggest customer. And they're actually nowadays part of Western Digital. Sony was also a customer of ours, and they sold it with an SSD that they sold. And Lexar also sold USB sticks with our product. And in this whole vulnerability disclosure process, only Western Digital and Sony actually replied to our contacts, our attempts at contact. And Lexar never really answered to us. But I have to remind you that both Sony and Lexar are actually not technically not customers of our anymore, of us anymore. So the timeline from our point of view, I'm now going to shift the perspective a bit to my point of view, because I actually got involved with ENC only in March and April of 2001. And that was because the company wanted to have an internal security assessment. So I did a small security assessment. I did not all the fancy stuff that Sylvain did with Ghidra and decompiling and debugging, etc. What I did was some simple tests that I could do. including looking at files with hex editors and modifying them. And actually, I found some similar things. I also asked just questions to the team. So how do you do the key derivation? Well, we use MD5 with 1,000 rounds for PBKDF2. Okay, so one of my findings is obviously that's not enough. So I gave them my report in April, and then my assignment was done. I'm a private contractor, so you know I was just hired for a small assignment. And then Sylvain disclosed his findings. ENC did acknowledge the vulnerability, but didn't do much more with it at that time, not yet. And then Sylvain disclosed his vulnerabilities to our business-to-business or OEM customers. So they started asking questions. And then ENC started to investigate the issues. We then spent from June to November upscaling our team, doing discussions internally with our customers, doing a new design, implementation, and testing. And as you can imagine, because I had been involved a few months before on the cryptographic assessment, I was also asked to help the company out with this. So that's what I did. And in the end, we actually managed to publish a new version which fixes the KDF issue. And what we still have on the roadmap is addressing the ciphertext malleability and the cipher strength issues. So one of the first things that happened, and when I was contacted, then my manager said, okay, so we've got this vulnerability report from a guy who I don't know, and is this real? Is this anything at all? And he was afraid it was because, you know, some of the same vulnerabilities were actually confirmed in his report. But yeah, so I just Googled Sylvain and I was like, okay, looks legit. He has done some stuff. The report was actually very well written. And honestly, if this would have been a paid assignment, the report would have been paid for. So that's really good work. And well, maybe even a bit too much for something that's basically for free. The report is also specific to our product. So it's not some random report which says you have vulnerabilities just in hopes to get a CVE mention or to get a bug bounty. We don't have a bug bounty program, but you know, these sort of things happen at times. And I also noticed that the terminology and the evidence presented really indicated that the author knows cryptography. So yeah, it was real. Sorry, guys, we really have to do something about it, which was already planned, but not at the speed that we now had to do stuff. And that sounds easy, right? Because just choosing a new KDF, new key derivation function, it's not rocket science. This problem has been solved before, basically. And also, the malleability issue, well, you use authenticated encryption and it's fixed. But anything is easy if you don't have to do it yourself, really. So let's take a look at what happened. Well, someone set us up the bomb, and it was Sylvain. So the company at the time was, and the product was in maintenance mode, which meant that we didn't have that many resources to work with. So we first had to get more people to upscale our team. We also had to figure out, okay, so what are we going to do? How are we going to fix it? How bad are these issues? And can we prioritize stuff? We had to make a design. And we also had to work more closely with our OEM customers than we did before. Like I said, Western Digital was still an active customer of ours, but this thing required more attention from them. And that's certainly they also wanted to look at the proposed resolutions that we wanted to implement. They wanted to make sure that it was actually fixed. So we had to work more closely with them than before. And everything had to be done fast. Okay, that's all very nice. So upscaling. We need more people. We need more hands. Where are we going to get them from? Because there is so much demand for tech skills and also crypto skills. It's really hard to find. This thing also happened during summer holidays, and many people are just not reachable at the time, or don't react as quickly. And in fact, myself, I also went on holiday, and you know, it was planned, it was booked. We were going on holiday. And we had to do everything in short notice. So we did get some extra people, but most of them were part-time. And that really doesn't help if you want to fix things quickly. The next thing that we did was obviously the triage part. So we looked at the key derivation function and what the actual risk to the users is. And obviously that depends a bit on the use cases, but with the findings from Sylvain about the key derivation function, that was pretty clear. It is a big risk for users. So we really wanted to get that fixed first. And we also expected that it's only a limited effort to do so. Then the other issue that was found, the malleability issue that was initially reported, well, that may not be so easy to actually abuse. There is, of course, the theoretical approach, which is actually not a malleability issue. So you can modify files, certainly, but it's hard to do a specific targeted change in the files. I'm going to actually explain a bit more about this in a later slide. So let's keep it at that. And we also expect this to take much more effort. So what we decided on was a staged approach. First, we wanted to fix the key derivation function, and then we wanted to fix the rest. So we had to choose a new key derivation function. And there were a few considerations that that were important for us. Of course, there was compatibility, because we have an existing product and we want users to be able to still open those vaults. Because if they can't open the vaults, we have a problem with our help desk. Also, they may never want to buy the product again. Performance is an issue. I mean, sure, people want security, but they also want performance. And many of these users, they are not perhaps the most technically skilled people. So for them, is usually performance is more important. Then obviously there's also security, because different KDFs have different security properties. And then there was implementation time and effort for us to actually implement that stuff. So those were the main considerations. Now, fireworks. So the different options that we considered were Argon2, balloon hashing, S-Crypt, PBKDF2, and then there's the question, how many iterations are we going to do? So the first three options here, they have an interesting property in the sense that they are memory hardened. They take a lot of memory to compute, and that helps against attacks using GPUs or dedicated cracking devices with ASICs or FPGAs. And PBKDF2 with even with HMAC SHA-256, that can be parallelized much better than the other three algorithms. However, looking from an implementation point of view, PBKDF2 was a lot easier for us because we use OpenSSL, and that's already included, and the other options are not. And you can try to build it from the components that OpenSSL gives you, but it takes more time. You actually have to verify it, because one of the things that we really went wrong in this in the software is that someone tried to implement PBKDF2 in his own implementation, but it's actually something that looks like PBKDF2, but is not. So we wanted to avoid that. And then there was also some discussion internally about the more proven solutions, because PBKDF2 has been around for quite some time, but the others are much newer. And then there is the question, how many iterations? Because our products actually run on older platforms, but also newer platforms, but also mobile platforms. So we were afraid that if we would do too many iterations, then we would actually have people, they would have to wait so long for opening their vault that it would they would not like it, or they would call the help desk, things like that. So Yeah, therefore, we actually decided to, in the end, to use PBKDF2, but only with 100,000 iterations and not a factor 3 more as recommended by OWASP. So then we actually faced some challenges implementing this stuff. We had limited team capacity. And on top of that, we actually did, the team was formed pretty quickly, but we still had to get to know each other, and some of us had to get to know the environment. And many of us were part-time, so we also had to know, like, okay, so when are people available and when not? We had to get into a common rhythm that actually works. So the ENC team was, like I said, was mostly part-time members, but we also worked closely with the testing team from Western Digital. And those people are actually in India. So we had different time zones. We also had to discuss some of the things with people from the United States. So more time zone stuff. Then we had holidays and festivities. As before, we started out during the summer. So there were summer holidays. And even in COVID times, there were still options to go on holiday, even though the options were limited, but they were there. And then there were some more festivities. For example, in India, there's a festival called Diwali, and that's a really important festival there. I guess it's a lot of fun. but people took a whole week off because that's what they do over there. And then a few weeks later, there was Thanksgiving in the US, which also meant that people were less available. Then we got people getting sick. Two people from our team got COVID. One actually was really offline for like 2 full weeks straight and then had to recover a bit. The other one had less trouble with it, but still. We also needed time to prepare statements for public release, web pages and everything, things that take sometimes more time than you'd expect them to. We had to fight scope creep, because there are more bugs in our software. Probably doesn't surprise you, but it's software, so it has bugs. And if you find them, the first thing you want to do is like fix it. But if you're under a tight deadline, sometimes you have to enter the discussion like, do we really have to fix this now, or can we fix this later? Then we also ran into some issues where Apple decided to make some updates to macOS, which actually broke our code. So that's all very nice that we were going to build a new release, but we also had to fix this because otherwise users would not be able to actually use it. Western Digital uses mobile applications, and the Play Store came out with new requirements. We had to use SDK 30. That didn't really work nicely on the first try. We also had limited testing capability. I'll show a bit more about that later. But part of the issue was that we couldn't test, we as ENC Security could not test the mobile apps because we didn't have the code. We didn't have an environment to test it on because those were actually developed by Western Digital. At the same time, we provided an API, which was actually used by them. So if there are issues in the API library, then you know we have to look at it. But if it's the application, they have to look at it. And also our API works both on Android and on iOS. And the underlying file system access calls, those are slightly different. So our API was sandwiched between an application layer and a file system layer. So that doesn't always make things easier to debug. And we had many, many different operating system product combinations to test. So I'm going to try and show that a bit. So the product is called DataVault, and there is DataVault version 6. There's a new iteration called DataVault version 7, and that's a slightly different code base, mostly different user interface. But DataVault 6 is also the basis for DataVault Lite, which is the Sony version, Secure Access, which is the old Western Digital version, and Private Access, which is the new Western Digital version. And it's also the basis for the Vault API. And this Vault API is used for three different mobile applications. So if you look at upgrade paths, and these are only upgrade paths for desktop versions, because the software runs on Windows and on Mac, and it has to run on different versions of Windows and different versions of macOS, right? We want the older versions of the software to be upgradable to newer and intermediate versions. And we also want all products to be able to upgrade to our paid version, because that's a source of income. So that's a lot of different upgrade paths to test. And it's not just an upgrade from software to software to software, but also from the file format to a file format that may be different. Then we also had some limitations on actually using the software, because we actually have limitations in those free versions on what kind of devices they can run. The full version can run on your hard disk or any USB stick, it doesn't matter. But the old version of Secure Access, the old version from Western Digital or SanDisk, only runs on SanDisk USB sticks. Then there's private access, which runs on SanDisk USB sticks, but also something called the iExpand Charger app, or iExpand Charger. And this is a device that can actually wirelessly charge your phone and perform a backup at the same time. So there's an app for on your phone to actually do this, to do the backup, and it's called the iExpand Charger app. And obviously this thing only works on if you got like one of those iExpand chargers. Similarly, on the Sony side, DataVault Lite only runs when you connect it to a Sony SSD. So that's all very nice. This one I could easily buy. This one, my manager gave me one, and this one I couldn't buy anymore, the Sony device. But, you know, I was hacking it like the 20s. I also used to do hacking like in the 90s or maybe even in the 80s with old computer games on my MSX. But the thing is that I could patch binaries to run on any device. That's not actually the situation that we want to test, because for us the limitation is a functional requirement. We also can just make debug builds that run on any device. There's a simple option for that in the build script. So what I did is I bought myself an Orispy Zero, and I ran Armbian on it, and I just made a script that can just load the GMAS storage kernel module and presented it with a fake vendor and product ID. And that way I can have an iExpand drive or an iExpand charger or a Sony SSD. It looks like this. All right, so as before, we had some challenges to face. And while you might think that fixing the key derivation function is easy, it turns out it is not always so easy. So we could not meet the deadline. And fortunately, Sylvain was allowing us to extend the deadline because he didn't want to increase the risk for users, because what would be the point? So finally, the new version went live on 2 December. And that's the part of the key derivation function. And then we had another thing to fix, which is the ciphertext malleability. So what we use is AES in counter mode. And like Sylvain said, we actually do, if we have more than AES-128, we do multiple rounds of the counter mode. But effectively, that is basically the same as if you know anything about counter mode, you make a key stream which you XOR on top of your plain text, which basically means that you make a more complicated key stream, which, you know, which is just two layers, but effectively it's the same thing. So what's the issue here with ciphertext malleability? So if this is the plain text, and this, if this is the plain text, this thing above here is the word test, all lowercase. And then you have a key stream and you XOR that on top of it, then you get this ciphertext. Now, what you see is because it's XOR, you know, if it's just two zeros, it becomes zero. If there's one of the two bits is one, then it becomes a one. And if both bits are one, it becomes a zero again. Okay. But what if I know something about the data, in something about the plain text, and I want to change it? For example, this I know this is test. If I want to make this lowercase t a capital T, I can do that by changing this bit. But now, oh, trying to select it, but it doesn't work in presentation mode. Sorry. If I change this bit to zero, then it becomes a capital T. And I can do that by changing this bit to a one, because I just have to flip the bit and in ciphertext, and it flips the bit in plain text. Now, that's fine for some applications, but you can do even worse. If you, for example, have an executable stored in this file, and an attacker knows what executable it is, so that exact attacker knows exactly bit by bit what is in the file, they can just replace that file by something else of the same size or smaller, because you can just chop off the end. You can't make it bigger because you don't have the keystream. But in that case, you know, you could replace an executable by a piece of malware. So it's not always easy to abuse this, but if you can, the result is double plus ungood, let's say. So the proven solution to this is just use some sort of a message authentication code. And there are several options to do this. You can use a cipher mode that is authenticated, like a counter mode with GMAC, or you can use HMAC. There are other constructs as well. But yeah, that sounds nice because it solves your problem completely. Because now it's authenticated. If someone screws around with any of the bits in here, the MAC will not match, and you will have detected that someone changed it. However, there are two ways of using a vault. We have copy in, copy out mode, which is what you saw in some of the screenshots from Sylvain. And that's where you copy a file into the vault or copy a file out of the vault. And you can do it with drag or drop, where you can use buttons. And with that mode, you always read or write the entire file. And then there is a mounting, which makes the vault available as part of your file system, either on a drive letter or as a folder in your, I think, your favorites. This feature is only available on the full paid product only, but that introduces some interesting side effects in this context. Because suppose you have a file, it contains all of your ciphertext, right? Because it's the encrypted file and there is a MAC somewhere stored. We would probably store it in the header in this case. Now, suppose you open the file, then you first have to do a full verification of that file. If that's a long file, that's going to take some time. If you change something in the file, doesn't matter if it's small or large, you have to recalculate the MAC for the entire file for each write. Now, suppose you would open a bunch of movie files. So you have like 256 gigabytes of movies in 4K. And in those movie files is usually included an icon so that you can just display the thumbnail, which is all well and good. But now if you open that vault and your viewer wants to show that icon, it will open that file, but that file will have to be checked out completely from A to Z, right? But that's an expensive operation. So opening that vault in your Explorer window might take like minutes. That would be annoying. And if you'd have some sort of application that changes only a few bytes in your file, you would have to spend a lot of time recalculating that MAC every single change. So that's not you know, from a performance point of view, it's not desirable. Now, an obvious solution would be to like turn a file into blocks and then perform a MAC on each block, and then it's more manageable. Because if you only need to read the first block, well, then you only need to, you know, check this out. Oh, actually, you also need to check all the other MACs with to make sure that the entire file is correct, because otherwise people might, you know, change something around here. You don't know that the entire file has been messed with. This setup actually gives you lower and much more predictable latency, which is good. It gives you higher performance for small reads and writes, which is good. But it will give you additional performance overhead for full reads and write, because now you need to do this for this MAC calculation for every block. And you also need to either maintain a Merkle tree, or you need to like combine all those MACs and check them out. It will give you more on-disk overhead, because now you've got more MACs stored. That's usually in the order of like 12.5% to like a few percent, depending on the block size that you choose. It gives you a lot more complexity, more error cases, more corner cases. So it's much more complicated. And it doesn't really fit into our current design. So it would be a lot of work. So yeah, what else? Are there alternatives? And yes, there are. What you could do is use an encryption mode that is much more resistant to malleability attacks. And that could be, for example, CBC mode or XTS. XTS is a good example because it's really hard to mess with things. I mean, you can certainly break some part of the file. That's really easy if you have write access. But then again, you can just destroy the entire file. You know, that's, if you can write, you're doomed. CBC mode has more options, more opportunity for malleability, because you can flip individual bits. And then you get a penalty of the, I believe the next block will be completely garbled. So it has more limitations than counter mode, but there are still some options. You can also use large block ciphers or all or nothing transforms. These things actually also help against people detecting where you changed things in the file. That's also good. Those are mitigations. They're not a full solution because it's still not authenticated encryption. But it's a mitigation. It really reduces the risk. And we can actually combine this with authenticated encryption of headers, because the headers are obviously the most important metadata that you have. They're small, so this is quite doable to actually perform authenticated encryption on. And that's actually what we intend to do to fix the malleability issue. We intend to implement XTS with authentication of headers. So one last thing. When I started out on my initial assignment for ENC, I think I had the same reaction to AES-1024 as Sylvain did. What? This thing does not exist. And I had some discussion with this about this with the people from ENC who have been around for a bit longer. And it turns out that the product has been sold to many different countries, and some of them are not part of the Wassenaar agreement. So there were export restrictions against them. And fortunately, it's not restricted to 40 or 48-bit export restrictions. That's something from the 90s. But they can only use AES-128. Sure. Not like, you know, people can't just use open source software, but whatever. I don't consider that highly effective. But that was a regulation, and if you're a company, you can get fined for breaking it. So, but marketing really wants to offer something stronger, because people feel like, okay, there's 128. Yeah, but can we make it stronger? Like, we want military grade. And actually, people outside the crypto industry, I think they have a more positive view on military grade encryption than us. So what was decided, okay, let's do multiple rounds of AES-128 and then call it 256, 512, 1024, because people understand bigger numbers. You can't say, yeah, we do 8 rounds. Okay, And then, of course, what I'm not saying here, but on this was not on the sheet, but apparently we do not do 8 rounds except for only the initial key wrapping of the file encryption key. So that's certainly an issue. But that's, yeah. So I wanted to explain why on earth this decision was ever made, because anyone who knows their stuff on cryptography, they look at AES-1024 and they say, okay, these people don't know what they're talking about. And it's marketing. Yeah. So I'm giving the floor back to Sylvain.
Yeah, thank you. So as we've seen during the presentation, and to sum up, the level of security is really difficult to assess for a full solution. It depends many things, the algorithm used, the work factors, number of iteration you perform your algorithm, and at the end, of course, the size of the keys used. So this project was really nice in terms of collaboration with ENC Security to me, and they handled the problems in the way they could, and I had a lot of meetings with them. And we collaborate a lot on this on the findings I got, which is not always the case. And I'm really happy that Boi could share the presentation, because for our point of view, we always have the attacker point of view, or often the attacker point of view in our community. And it's nice to see all the constraints which happen when, in fact, behind people have to patch what we have found. And it's interesting to understand their problem at the end. So this is it for us. If you have further questions, we'll be happy to answer during the Q&A session, or you can contact us on Twitter, GitHub, or by email. Thank you very much.
I want to add that we also enjoyed the cooperation with Sylvain. it was very pleasant to work with you, and we were happy that you spent the time for us to do so, because basically you don't have to. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. It was a really interesting talk, although I do have to admit I'm not that deep into cryptography as you two are. Thanks a lot. And I heard that the interest was very high. So congratulations for that. Reminder for everybody at home, if you want to submit questions, feel free to do so on Twitter or on Twitter, Mastodon, or in the IRC with the hashtag r3s in the Feediverse, or in the channel r3s in IRC. So we have some questions already. First and foremost, before I forget it, because I don't have it noted down, from people here on premise, how much of a pain in the back was it to discover this and get it and get everything working?
I'm not used to Windows reverse, so it was interesting to me to get back to that. It was not that painful, except for the encryption part, where I had to look to OpenSSL source code, to match this part. But otherwise, it was quite okay. There were no debug protection and so on. So it was quite and function ID was working quite good.
Okay, thank you very much. So let's go to the first question from the audience. Are there signs that this solution for 1024 bits is broadly used or only found here?
So it is used by many people, mostly by people using SanDisk USB sticks. I can't give you actual numbers, but it's a fair amount of people.
So it's the setup is only you've only seen it with exactly the set of devices you described. It's not broadly used in terms of it's not an industry standard, as you would say.
It's not an industry standard, no, certainly not.
Okay.
What we can see is the update request, because the software has a built-in update function. And we can see the request to the update server to see if there's a new version available. And that also reports the version numbers that are actually used by the software. So that there we can see, we can make an estimate of how many people are using it.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. Furthermore, would a tech illiterate end user ever want to use this type of security products, as opposed to just using well-known software that or the built-in disk encryption in the operating system?
It's a bit different than full disk encryption. It's file encryption, and the solution is quite simple. It's by default on the disk, and it's quite simple to use. So, yeah, if you don't know a lot, I mean, if you don't know a lot on this kind of software, then you will use it, and it's quite simple.
I do have to interpret the question, but I'm not sure whether that's the intended. What they intended to say, but how I would see it is, would you recommend a end user to use this to protect their assets, or would you rather recommend, look, do software encryption and leave this thing aside?
So the examples that we got in the question are basically all block device encryption. And that's not always working for all scenarios. So if you need file encryption, you will need to use something else. And there are actually also other alternatives available, even open source ones. What I think is really interesting about, especially the combination with our software with SanDisk, is that you can actually use it on the iPhone as well, because using USB sticks on an iPhone is not a given. You have to make something special to actually make it work as a vendor. And this software of SanDisk actually includes an encryption option.
Okay.
So I like that.
Yeah, sure. Thanks. Did you have a look at DMcrypt with DM integrity for doing file encryption? I do see that also as a... Yeah, please take it if you want to answer that.
So, no, we did not look at that. Not in the sense that we cannot use DM and we cannot use a device mapper stuff from Linux, because this is software for Windows and for macOS.
Okay, yeah.
And it's file encryption and not block encryption.
Sure, yeah. That's what I thought. How did the migration of existing vaults work for the end user?
So it's actually relatively simple. As soon as you start a new version and you open the vault, it will tell you that the vault has been upgraded. That's it. You have to open it, you have to specify the password, and then it will upgrade it for you, which means that the key encryption key will be re-encrypted, and we will now also write the salt, because the previous version had a static salt, as Sylvain correctly concluded. So we need to write a salt for every vault, and that's what we do. And then you need to re-encrypt the key encryption key.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah.
And for now, the last question. What do you think about using ECC in military-grade cryptography?
I've never heard about ECC military-grade encryption, but I would be happy to know and to look at it. It would be really fun.
Okay, thank you very much. So far I don't see any new questions. Let me refresh my pad. Thank you very much for your talk. It was really interesting, and as again the interest from the community was there. So thanks a lot.
I just have a one remark.
Sure.
my contribution to John's repo was merged recently to the main repo. So now you just need to update your John the Ripper repository. You don't need to use mine anymore.
Ah, okay, cool. So John the Ripper, it has been updated from the talk. We have one last question. I do think we have time for that. Have you considered data format compatibility with existing file-based encryption schemes such as EncFS?
No, we haven't.
Okay.
No.
Thanks. So, and with that, I will hand you over to our backstage crew, so to say.